Our gracious Heavenly Father, as we open Thy Word to study today, honor the Word, the name of Jesus, the shed blood, and save by Thy marvelous grace some poor lost sinner today. May some soul hear the Word, believe the Word, receive the Lord Jesus Christ, and be born into God's family. We ask it in Jesus' name and for Jesus' sake. Amen. Yesterday, I declared that God has done all that God can do. Jesus has done all that He can do. That is, He cried out, "It is finished," and gave His Spirit back to the Heavenly Father. And I declared yesterday that all there is left for anyone to do is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and He will save by His grace, and God forgives the sinner for Christ's sake. Now, today I'm continuing, and I want us to follow this line of thought. Salvation is not a trade between God and the sinner. That is, God does not trade us grace for our sins. We do not trade God our sins and iniquity for saving grace. Salvation is pure kindness on the part of God. God saves through pure kindness, not obligation. God was not obligated to give Jesus or to send Jesus or to set Him forth to be a propitiation for our sins. It was pure kindness that caused God to allow Jesus to take the sinner's place. In Titus 3 and verse 3, we ourselves were sometimes foolish, disobedient, serving divers lust and pleasure, living in malice, envy, hateful, and hating one another. Now, please listen carefully. Titus 3 and verse 4. But after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared. Let me read again. But. Now, in verse 3, Paul gives us a word picture of the sinner, foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving different kinds of lust and pleasure, living in malice, envy, hateful, hating one another. But, see, that connecting word, Paul uses it so many times in these epistles. But after that, the kindness and love of God, the kindness of God, the grace of God, beloved, grace is God's divine love in action. Now listen to me very carefully. But after the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He saved us. According to His mercy He saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior. Which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior. Now let me read those verses again, and I'm going to make some strong statements today. I'm not taking issue with anyone. I'm not taking issue with any religion. I'm just preaching the pure, unadulterated gospel of God's grace. Now listen carefully. But, after, in other words, in verse 3, he gives us the picture of the sinner. The horrible, horrible, ugly picture of the sinner. But, in spite of all that, but after the kindness and, now notice that, the kindness and, they are not synonymous in that love and kindness are one and the same and inseparable and so on, but after the kindness and love, through God's kindness, through God's grace, the love of God Jesus Christ came down to man. Now hear me well, listen carefully. But after the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy, according to His mercy, He saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which He, God our Savior, which God our Savior shed on us abundantly through, God our Savior shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Now, notice how the Holy Ghost links God the Savior, Jesus Christ the Savior, in these verses. Now, I do not see one word about the minister, the evangelist, the missionary, the teacher, the preacher, the baptismal pool, or the River Jordan. I don't see one word about ceremony or ritual or feast or holy days or holidays. I don't see one word, I do not see one suggestion about human merit or human goodness or anything else. I just see that after the kindness and love of God our Savior, toward man appeared, I see, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to God's mercy, God our Savior, God's mercy, God saved us. He saved us, that's God, by how? How did he save us? By the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly. Now, I say this without any fear. I say it without reservation. I say it without hesitation. It's an insult to God's wisdom, God's righteousness, God's mercy, and God's grace for any man to tell you that it's necessary for you to join anything, be baptized in a river or a baptistry, do anything such as give your money or give a certain amount of your time or anything else, doesn't make any difference. It's an insult to God for any man to tell you that you must join or be baptized or give or do or anything else to be saved by grace. Now understand, to be saved by grace, to be redeemed by grace, to be delivered from the penalty of sin by grace. I'm talking about salvation. I'm not talking about stewardship. I'm not talking about eternal reward as a child of God. I'm talking about becoming a child of God. There is not one thing you can do but receive. Receive, and that's by faith. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. So there's Jesus. You can't separate God the Father, God the Son, God the Word, Jesus the Word. You can't separate these divine things, beloved friends, as having to do, persons as having to do with redemption. I'm talking about redemption. I'm talking about salvation from the penalty of sin through the grace of God. God doesn't trade salvation to you. That is, God doesn't trade grace to you in return for your sins, in return for you joining a church or being baptized. Now let me tell you something quickly. I am a member of a church. I have been immersed in water in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. I do partake of the Lord's Supper. I do give much more than 10% of my income. I do work and go to church and go to Sunday school. I do try to be good and live clean and do all the good I can. But the reason I do those things is because I trusted Jesus. He redeemed me through his kindness and through the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. I'm not doing anything to add anything to my redemption. Now let me say this hurriedly. Through the death of Jesus on Calvary, through the blood of Jesus shed on Calvary, in every case, God is free to save. God is free to save and forgive and cleanse through the death of Jesus. But it is only through the cross, only through grace, that God saves in any case. God does not forgive sinners because he is big-hearted. Oh, no. God does not acquit the sinner because he is big-hearted enough to remit the penalty of sin. God cannot acquit the wicked. In other words, the only way that God can grant to us salvation is through the shed blood and the finished work of the Lamb of God on the cruel cross. God pardons sinners because the sin debt has been paid in full on the cross by Jesus Christ. In John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. Jesus took away the sin of the world. He paid the sin debt. He was made sin. He was made a curse. He overcame. He is the one who conquered the world, the flesh, the devil, death, hell, and the grave. And now God can be just and justify the ungodly. Let me read another verse. Now listen. But after the kindness. Listen to Ephesians 2 and verse 4. Now if you read the first three verses, and I'm not going to read them because I don't have time. In Ephesians 2, 1, 2, and 3, you'll read the description of the sinner. As I read it in Titus, you'll read the description of the ungodly man. And then in verse 4, Ephesians 2, 4, but God. There's that word again, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together. With Christ by grace ye are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now here's the verse that I've been leading to. That in the ages to come he, now that's God, might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness. In his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. I read that scripture to get to verse 7, the kindness. In other words, that he, God, in the ages to come, might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness. It is pure kindness, pure grace, no human merit. Not because God is a big, loving Father, and God, because he is big-hearted, forgives the sinner because he has a big heart. That's not it, my friend. God is kind toward us because of the horrible, horrible, horrible death that Jesus died on the cruel cross. Now then, I want you to turn to Romans chapter 3, a very familiar passage, and yet we can't use it too many times, and I cannot emphasize it too strongly. We read in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned. I've pointed out many times in this series that we are all under sin. We are all under unbelief. We are all in one category. We are all in the same boat. Until we believe on Jesus, we are all dead unbelievers and under sin and condemnation. For all have sinned, Romans 3:23. All have sinned, come short of the glory of God, being justified freely. Now I'm going to talk about pardon and justification in just a moment. Being justified freely by his grace. Now we're justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in. Are you listening? Are you listening? Through the redemption that is in joining the church, being immersed in water, living the best you can, giving 10% of your income, bringing all the tithes into the storehouse, going to church and Sunday school, and abstaining from evil and doing unto others as you would have them do. Oh, no, no. No, 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 no. That's not in the Word of God. Well, you say, now, preacher, why did you read it in there? I did it to try to wake you up, to try to shake you, and to try to get you to stop and see what God's Word teaches. Through the redemption that is in, not the church, not the baptistry, not your good works, not your tithing, not your living good, not the golden rule, but in Christ Jesus. In God's Christ who became our Jesus. God giving his Christ to become our Jesus to save us. Now listen to this. Next verse. Redemption is in Christ Jesus, my friend. And there is therefore now no condemnation of them who are in Christ Jesus, Romans 8:1. And Christ in you, the hope of glory, Colossians 1:27. And I warn you, it doesn't make any difference how good you live, how much you give, how many times you've been baptized, or what church you belong to, or what religion you belong to. It makes no difference what you think or believe or practice. If you're not redeemed in Jesus, if you're not in Jesus, then you're lost, just as hopelessly lost as the poor heathen who doesn't even know that there is a Jesus or a Bible. You're lost. I don't care what you've done, what you're doing, what you're giving, what you're living. It doesn't make any difference. Redemption is in Christ Jesus. And if you're not in Christ, you're lost. I'm reading verse 25 now. Whom God, that is Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His BLOOD, blood, to declare God's righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God, now watch it, to declare, I say, at this time, His, God's righteousness, that He, God, might be just, and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Now get it? Redemption is in Christ Jesus. And God justifies all who believe in Jesus. Where is boasting then? It is excluded by what law? Works? No, but by the law of faith. Therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Seeing it is one God which shall justify the circumcision by faith, and the uncircumcision through faith. Now then, do we then make void the law of God through faith? No, God forbid, we establish the law. Jesus came and fulfilled every jot and every tittle of the law, Matthew 5:17. What the law could not do because of the weakness of the flesh, God did in the likeness of sinful flesh in Jesus, Romans 8:1-4. Read those verses and study them. Now, let me come back to this verse and show you what I mean. We have redemption through Jesus Christ. Verse 24, Romans 3:24. Redemption is in Christ Jesus. Then, verse 26, we are justified when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, pardon, let me put it this way, and I think you'll appreciate it more fully. Pardon subtracts, or forgiveness subtracts, and justification adds. Now what do I mean by that? We read in Colossians 2:13, having forgiven you all trespasses. When we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and put our faith in His shed blood, God forgives all our trespasses. Why? All we like sheep have gone astray. All we like sheep have gone astray. But Jehovah laid on Jesus the Lamb the iniquity of us all. That's Isaiah 53:6. Having forgiven you all trespasses, Colossians 2:13. Now when we believe on Jesus and when we trust in His shed blood, God subtracts all sins. But that's not enough, beloved. That's not enough. If God had taken away all of my sins the moment I believed on Him and had left me to walk this pilgrim journey alone, then it would not have been many hours or even moments, certainly not many days, until I would have been right back in the same old gutter, the same old rut, the same old path, sin. But that's where the marvelous grace of God comes in. God's grace not only saves us from our sins, but God imputes righteousness. When God subtracts our sins, God puts in a new heart. God gives us a new heart. God gives us a new spirit. In other words, in the language of the Apostle Paul, therefore, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation. Now, that doesn't mean that God gives us new flesh. We'll get a new body when we stand before God and we see Jesus, we'll be like Him. But when God redeems us, He gives us a new inner man. We are created in Christ Jesus, a new man. Therefore, we do the things of the Spirit. We walk not after the flesh, because the Lord is our shepherd. He is my shepherd. He is your shepherd if you're born again. And He leadeth me, He leadeth His children into paths of right living. So, God subtracts our sins. God imputes righteousness. We are made partakers of divine nature. We are a new creation in Christ Jesus, and it all happens through the marvelous saving grace of God. Hallelujah. Thank God for His saving grace. Father, in the name of Jesus, honor Thy word, the shed blood, and save some precious soul. Save especially that soul that's nearest hell, for Christ's sake. Amen.